Good morning and welcome to the Lutheran Church of the Resurrection, and welcome to Jerusalem. Lent has taken us to this place, to Holy Week, the holiest week of the church year. And it begins today with Palm Passion Sunday, Jesus' entry into Jerusalem to start that Holy Week. It is also Confirmation Sunday here at the Lutheran Church of the Resurrection, and we honor those five confirmands and their families and pray that the relationships that they have begun will continue and flourish in the days to come. Welcome to worship. And now we continue our service with the procession of the palms. Blessed be the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it,' and we'll send it back here immediately." They went out and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. And as they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who were following were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for the redeeming the world through our Savior Jesus Christ. Today he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Bless these branches and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that joined to his death and resurrection, we enter into life with you. Through the same Jesus Christ who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Redeemer King.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Let us pray. Everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and in the glorious victory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Kids, you guys have seen the palm fronds that we have waved here, and I know you got in the mail palm fronds from Miss Sharon. And Sarah, my daughter, has made an example for us. Sarah, do you want to hold it up over here to show everybody? Okay. So we have a palm frond that Sarah made. Can you take that up by the pulpit and show it to everybody? And it, what does it say on that palm frond, Sarah? Hosanna, that's right. That's the phrase, the word we say when Jesus comes into Jerusalem. It means, God, save us now. And you know, that's what God is doing in Jesus. He is saving us now, which is really awesome. But we go from Palm Sunday, and we just heard that gospel reading, and we're going to hear more about what will happen to Jesus. And later in this week of Holy Week, Jesus will gather with his disciples in the upper room, and he will share a meal with them, and it will be the gift of what we now receive as Holy Communion. This is a communion cup that we have, and it's very beautiful. And we're going to have that service on Monday, Thursday this week, on Thursday. And then on Friday is Good Friday. Sarah, can you hold up the cross for everybody to see? So we have a cross here, a crucifix, actually. You can see Jesus' body on here. Yes, that's right. All right, and on here we see Jesus is dying on the cross. And that's what happens on Good Friday. And we're going to hear this story of how Jesus was crucified and died today, in just a minute, actually. So I want you to listen close, Sarah, for this story of how Jesus died. It's a sad story, but it's also a story that has something very interesting that happens at the end. And I want you to listen closely, and I want everybody at home to listen closely, for what is said about Jesus, what's said about him at the very end of the reading, okay? So listen closely. Let's pray. God, our Father, we thank you for Jesus. We shout Hosanna when he comes into Jerusalem. God, save us now. And in his cross, we see, God, that you are saving us now. Open our eyes and our ears to Jesus as he saves us. In his name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Sarah. I'll send you back to your seat. The Holy Gospel, according to Mark, the 15th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests had a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priest accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have them release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led Jesus into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed Jesus in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed and spat on him and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away. They led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." And in the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
In the heart of our Christian message, the heart of our Christian faith, we hear that Jesus died crucified. We hear that Jesus died praying. We hear that Jesus died abandoned. Jesus died crucified. And yet through his death, something we may not have noticed before comes into focus. The centurion says it first, but we see it too. Did you hear what the centurion said? In Jesus, we see the self-giving, the final and fullness of God's self-giving through the cross. And we see that there is nothing that will prevent him from being faithful to the Father's mission to save the world. crucified. We see Jesus is faithful to the Father's mission, to the point of death, even death on a cross. Our eyes, they join the gaze of Christians throughout the ages to see the truth of the cross, that Jesus is God's Son. And Jesus died praying. Through his death, we see not simply the start of the prayer, but we also in his death see the culmination of that prayer as well. Jesus prays the start of Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, it's a psalm of great anguish, as no doubt the cross, it was a place of great anguish. And yet, though the psalm dwells in that crucified place for the first 20 verses, it takes a turn at verse 21. In verse 21, the psalm declares of God, God, you have rescued me. And in verse 24, the Lord did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. And the psalm concludes on a high note in verse 31. Future generations will proclaim God's deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying to them, the Lord has done it. Or in other words, it is complete. Or you might have heard the prayer that Jesus prays, it is finished. Yes, Jesus, he died praying a psalm that began with the lament of being forsaken by God, and yet ends with this bold faith in the God who comes to the rescue, who came to the rescue of his people long ago, and the God who will do it again and is doing it here in Jesus. Jesus died with this faith on his lips, this faith overflowing from his soul. And it is in his passion, in his death and resurrection, that we see God's victory finished, completed, done. Jesus died abandoned. Did you hear how everybody abandoned Jesus? The disciples, the leader, the mob, the soldiers, everyone abandons him. In one of the stories about Jesus and his disciples, there's even this one disciple who almost got caught up with Jesus, but he wiggled out of his clothes and ran away to save his own skin. Do you know what it means to abandon God? Well, that's sin. That's sin, to be separated from God. And that's what sin is at its core. And every sin is an abandonment of God, just in different forms. We abandon God with our words, with our thoughts, with our deeds. The people of the Bible in this story just did it in different ways than we do sometimes. And yet here's the heart of the Christian message, the heart of the Christian faith, that Jesus gives his life for those who have abandoned him. And through his death, he brings about the healing of this wound caused by the abandonment. Abandoned, Jesus heals the sin wound of the world. It is through his death that Jesus saves his people from their sin. It is through his death that Jesus saves you from your sin. Confirmands, you have been studying the heart of our Christian faith centered in our Lord Jesus crucified and risen. You have been studying this that you might receive it and that today you might affirm it as well. Confirmands, may your affirmations today, may they be simply the next breath in your life of affirming this faith in Jesus the crucified. Now I have a message for each of you based on your confirmation verse that you have chosen. Though perhaps by God's grace, it's not just a message for one of you, but for all of God's people. So Karina and Michael, be strong, be bold in your faith. For it is true that the Lord your God, the one who freed Israel from slavery in Egypt, the Lord your God who went with Moses and Joshua, the Lord who was crucified and raised on the third day, he does go with you too. See it in his cross. Look to his cross, and there you will see that he will not leave you nor forsake you. Miller, keep your eyes focused on Jesus and his cross. For it is in him that you will know the truth. He who is truth itself, truth crucified, truth raised on the third day, and he will make you free. Ella, people look for strength and for courage in all kinds of places, in weapons and in money. But you find your strength in Jesus Christ. When you are frightened and dismayed like Joshua, seek the Lord your God and his strength. For wherever you go, the one who has called you in baptism, the one who has filled you with the Holy Spirit, the one who was crucified and raised on the third day, that God is with you wherever you go. And Noah, it is true that Jesus gives his life, both for the foolish and for the wise. You, Noah, seek wisdom. You seek the wisdom of our God that is revealed in and through the passion of our Lord Jesus. Seek God's wisdom on display here in Christ's cross. For the one who has given his life for you will also make you wise. Through his passion, your crucified God is turning you from evil so that you might join your will with his will in seeking that which is truly good. Confirmands, and all you people of God, in this Holy Week, fix your eyes on our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
Dear friends in Christ, we give thanks for the gift of baptism and for these people, one with us in the body of Christ, who are making public affirmation of their baptism. Today, I present to you Karina, Miller, Michael, Ella, and Noah. All of them desire to make public affirmation of their baptism.
Okay, so my name is Michael Jelinek, and my confirmation Bible verse is Deuteronomy 31:6, which is, "Be strong and bold, have no fear or dread of them, because it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not fail or forsake you."
My name is Miller Kerwin, and my verse is John 8:31-32. And it goes, "So Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed him, 'If you continue my word, then you are truly disciples of mine, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free.'"
My name is Eleanor Schmidt, and my Bible verse is Joshua 1:9. "Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go."
My name is Noah Thornton, and my confirmation verse is Proverbs 14:16-17. "The wise are cautious and turn away from evil, but the fool throws off restraint and is careless. One who is quick-tempered acts foolishly, and the schemer is hated."
"Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them, for the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you."
Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for these sisters and brothers whom you have made your own by water and the word in baptism. You have called them to yourself, enlightened them with the gifts of your Spirit, and nourished them in the community of faith. Uphold your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism, and unite the hearts of all whom you have brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ. Amen.
And so with our confirmands, I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God?
I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Having made public affirmation of their faith, we will ask our confirmands if they intend to continue in the covenant that God made with them in holy baptism. It is the same covenant that God has made with you when you were baptized. This covenant is to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people, following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Each confirmand will respond, "I do," and "I ask God to help and guide me." People of God, do you promise to support these sisters and brothers in Christ and to pray for them in their life in Christ? If so, answer, "We do," and we ask God to help and guide us.
We do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
So let us pray. We give thanks to you, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give us new birth, cleanse us from sin, and raise us to eternal life. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in our confirmands the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm their faith, guide their life, empower them in their serving, give them patience in suffering, and bring them to everlasting life. Amen.
Amen.
Let us rejoice together with these sisters and brothers in Christ. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share that with each other. Peace.
Peace be with you.
God's peace be with you. Christian faith is all about giving of gifts. In holy baptism, God gifted us with God's self, a promise to be with us to the close of the age. In the rite of confirmation, we gift back to ourselves, back to God, and we give God thanks for these five young people. And we give God thanks for the offerings that this congregation continues to gift back to God in response to God's love and grace, so that the ministries we all share might go forth in God's name. Thank you.
My worth and my unworthiness.
trust in no other. My soul is satisfied in Him alone.
Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. In Jesus, you came among us as a suffering servant. Give your church humility. Redeem your people from pride and the certainty that we always know your will. Heal us and empower us to confess Christ crucified. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In creation, life springs from death. Redeem your creation awaiting resurrection. Restore lost habitats and endangered species. Create new possibilities for areas affected by climate change. Grant relief from natural disasters and nurture new growth. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Jesus was handed over to the powers of this world. In all nations, instruct the powerful that they would not exploit their power, but maintain justice. Sustain soldiers, and guide those who command them, that they serve those in greatest need. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
On the cross, Jesus joined all who feel forsaken. Abide with those who are condemned to death. Defend those who are falsely accused. Console and strengthen those who are mocked or bullied. Accompany all who suffer, especially those affected by COVID-19, grant respite and renewal. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You called followers to tend to Jesus' body in death. Sustain hospice workers and funeral directors. Bless this congregation's ministries at time of death. Those who plan and lead funerals, those who prepare meals, all who offer support in grief. Be with all people, especially those in Atlanta and Boulder, who mourn the deaths of their loved ones lost to violence. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You inspired the centurion to confess Jesus as your son. We praise you for the faith you have given to people of all places and times. Give us also such faith to trust the promises of baptism, and with them look for the resurrection of the dead. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray with confidence in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Holy Week services continue. Maundy Thursday, there will be a noon service and a 7 o'clock service. Good Friday, the same, noon and 7 o'clock. Easter Sunday morning, we will have 3 worship services, 8, 9:30, and 11 o'clock. As we move to the cross and beyond, the hope of the gospel is that this Holy Week will not end with Easter, but will continue on into the season of Easter and beyond. You are welcome to this holy journey with us. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with blessings and gift you with peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Sin, that we might become His righteousness. He
humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord above. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The golden rule, the veil was torn. Oh, so amazing, oh, so amazing, Jesus Messiah, Lamb of the Lambs, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Our hope is in you. Our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, the light of the world.
Go in peace, share the good news.
Thanks be to God.
And two, and three, and four, and...
Thank you.